Good morning from New York and Happy New Year to everyone viewing this upcoming structural and valve specifically disease related live case website from our internet portal. Before we go to the live case, let me introduce myself, George Dengas from Mount Sinai Medical Center in New York. Few information regarding the website, and let me first let you know that whatever you see today, in case you miss a few parts, it will be up and running full length in a few days in the archives part of the website, same way, for example, the December or the earlier webcasts of structural heart life cases have been and are already in the website, and you can also find there all the relevant CME information. Our next appointment here will be March 14, same day and time, anywhere you are around the world, on a Tuesday as usual, again, same time as today. If you want a question or if you want to ask a question or have a comment, you can email me at info@structuralheartlifecases.org. 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 I will answer your question or pass it on to the operators to address them during the discussion. And without further delay, let's go to the cardiac cath labs of Mount Sinai Hospital in the hybrid room to meet our operation team for today.
All right, good morning, George, and great for that introduction. And we are ready and we have the whole team. Just to say again, myself, Dr. Sharma, on my left is Dr. Keeney, right, Jason, and then we have our two surgical colleagues, Dr. Alan Stewart and Dr. Gilbert Tang. So lot of, this is a very, a special case, so we need a lot of brain power as well as the manual that how to do this case correctly. This is a case number 15 in our structure live webcast. We had done 14 with the tower. This is the 14th tower, and one case we did with the alcohol septal ablation. So that it has been quite popular now. As you saw, I showed the data on last week. We have about 1800 page views per month, so really getting popularity, but continued the type of more complexity like we do for coronary, will get more, attract more viewers to try to learn, and knowing that the structural is taking the prime seat as an intervention, will continue to grow. With that note, let's start with the slide presentation. This is supported by Edward Life Sciences, and with the main supporter being then others being Medtronic, Bard, and Terumo. Next, these are our disclosures. Next, so this is a 84-year-old patient who has worsening dyspnea, class 3 heart failure symptoms, and has a preserved ejection fraction, on a OK medication, and has severe aortic stenosis. And we did a cath, has a non-obstructive CAD with a mild pulmonary hypertension. Next. So CT, we'll go through it. Basically, patient has a good femoral arteries, and the risk mortality came out to be a 3.4. STS makes it in the intermediate risk category, and so. Then that is the plan today, will be the Sapien 3 tower. Next. So with the echo, I'll hand over to our echo chief, Dr. Sen Partho Gupta, and will tell us what exactly live he's seeing. This patient has a severe aortic stenosis by the numbers. So, Partho.
Thank you, Dr. Sharma. So, here back at the console at the front end, we have the anesthesia team, Dr. Trin, and the patient is currently under conscious sedation. And what you're seeing actually is a live conscious sedation, three-dimensional TEE, and the patient is tolerating it very well. So,
but tell us this magic, how do you do the conscious sedation and TEE?
So this is a great collaboration between the anesthesia, which allows a deeper sedation. The patient is tolerating the sedation pretty well. And under such circumstances, if the patient tolerates the probe, we've seen that you get incredible images. And therefore, in such a situation where aortic root anatomy is important and you want to get concordant information between CT and echo, It could be useful to have a full-fledged three-dimensional echo to assessment. And what you see here currently is the unfast three-dimensional view of the aortic valve, and it's a tri-leaflet aortic valve. And what you can see very well here that there is actually a calcific nodule. Right here, you can see the calcific nodule. This calcific nodule is in the commissure between the right coronary and the left coronary cusp. And there are not much other calcific nodules except for this nodule here. And if you look into the two-dimensional view, this is a tri-leaflet valve, and the patient has aortic stenosis with mild to moderate aortic valve regurgitation. And also, further assessment of the aortic root anatomy reveals that the aortic valve annular area is about 4.2, 4.3 centimeters square with diameters of 2.5 and 2.1. And also we put some more emphasis in this particular case because of a low left main. And you will see here, this is important view in the short axis view. You can see here the color in flow in the left main. And this is very important to interrogate, because during the procedure, as soon as the valve is deployed, you want to quickly check how is the left main flowing, and this is an important information. And on this particular view, as you will see here, the crosshair lines, you can directly measure. This is the ostium of the left main, and if you measure directly from here, and this is the annulus, it's about 1 to 1.1 centimeters. So this is kind of a lowish left main ostium in that regard. And the patient has the preserved left ventricular function, and there is, as I said earlier, mild to moderate aortic valve regurgitation, and there's also confirmation of the severe aortic valve stenosis with the gradients taken and reconfirmed from the deep transgastric views. So overall, the patient is tolerating the procedure, the TEE, pretty well in the conscious sedation, and this could be useful under such challenging situation where there is a low left main, and if there are concerns, we can immediately give the information, the dynamic information from the echocardiography to the team.
Yeah, that's an interesting observation. Partho, let me make a comment that perhaps you can show the three-dimensional view what I'm making this point, that the nodule is not at the base of that that leaflet. It's like mid-portion. So we expect it to have maybe more of a movement during the deployment of the new valve.
Yes.
And that is a specific feature that we also need to understand. A nodule that's more towards the base, as is relatively mobile, but a nodule a little bit further out.
That's correct.
Is going to cross some distance and approach there.
Yeah, and also if you see it very carefully, the left coronary, the aortic sinus is not really having much major calcific burden, and this nodule is more on the right side, so I'm not anticipating it to migrate towards the left ostium. And some of these dynamic information can be very useful and can allow some more confidence as you do
now
the procedures.
In this view, we see the non-coronary cusp barely moving.
Yep.
Does that mean it's, I don't think I saw it as so immobile in the two-dimensional view. What do you attribute this difference?
Well, I mean, this is just aortic valve stenosis, the non-mobility of the non-coronary cusp. Now you can see here in a slightly more better clarity. It's not really having too much of calcific burden.
Not
this is the only calcific nodule here, which was a little concerning. But again, this is the ostium here. This is far away. And this is the left coronary cusp, which doesn't have too much calcium. And in fact, it's a slightly diminutive type of a leaflet. So
it's a little smaller, but not that much calcium.
Yep. Yeah. And I think that let's ask Alan on this point, knowing that this whole issue about the outflow tract calcific nodules are really creating a problem, and they're actually exclusion for the low risk. So Alan, how do you see when you're doing a surgical valve resection that this we know that these are all calcific aortic valves, but what about this? Lot talked nowadays on the subvalvular or outflow tract calcification, knowing that those are the one cause annular rupture and so.
It's very easy from a surgical point of view to just peel that calcium away. It's really not embedded too far into the annulus, so with a pair of forceps and a scissor, we can generally clean out that outflow tract. From the patients, the few patients remaining that we actually do open heart surgery on for aortic stenosis. We've gotten keen on sutureless valves, which we no longer put pledgets in the annulus. We no longer sew them in. We can just deploy much in the same way as a TAVR. The difference is we take out the old valve, we take out the subvalvular calcium, and then we can deploy a valve that has no skirt to it. So that's become sort of an exciting advance of surgery. But here, obviously, we'll be a little careful. We've now gotten advanced techniques to avoid annular rupture, but it is a higher risk here for patients with subvalvular calcification.
Okay, let's move on. Continue our slide presentation now. We go to the next part. Keep going with the CT. JK, you take over now.
Good morning, everybody, and Happy New Year. So I'll step you through the CTI measurements now. You can see first we start with the annulus. Very similar measurements to what we've got with the echo, that the main diameter is about 24 millimeters. And the true annulus itself, as you'll see there, is not too heavily calcified. While there was that nodule up in the non-coronary cusp, when we come down to the level of the annulus is not too severely calcified, or just really mildly calcified, just a few specks, which does mean the risk of rupture goes down a little bit here. Perimeter measurement's about 75, 76, and the area we got by CTA is 4.4. And it's interesting to note that minor small discrepancy between the echo and the CT. This is normal, and in fact the ranges that we use for sizing the valve are slightly different between the CT and the echo, but 4.4 for the area on CT. Annular angle is fairly standard, about 64 degrees. Next slide. You can see the sinus of Valsalva are reasonably sized, about 32 millimeter mean. Sinotubular junction height is adequate at 21. Ascending aorta is fine at 32. You can see there on the bottom right panel, the left main height by CTA, we're getting about 10 millimeters, with an added point of note that there's a significant piece of calcium right at the left main ostium there. And we'll come to discuss the heights or importance of the left main for TAVR in a moment. Yeah. Next slide. You can see the axis here is fairly benign. We've got adequate, not too tortuous, and some spotty calcification, but nothing too severe. Next. You can see here our vessel sizes. They're around 8 millimeters, 8 to 10, both sides. Next.
Go back, actually. You know the left main, I think this is one of the important. Go back to the slide, two back. Yeah, here. So I think this is the left main issue is the one which has been quite troublesome, particularly that, coronary occlusion can occur. It occurs a little more with the balloon expandable valve versus the self-expanding. And of course, the predictors have been, once particularly when you do valve and valve, and of course the small valve size, and the height we know. And second is the sinus of Valsalva mean of less than 30 millimeters. So if you have a combination of two, particularly these heights are 10 millimeter, and this is where the whole issue that can you preempt, knowing that the valve is there, we have some experience. Anu, you want to comment on that? What do we do? Why this left main occludes sometimes in these cases?
I think more important is the height that has been just mentioned. This, I would say, still is probably we would say, yeah, it's low. 10 is less, anything less than 11, we have to be concerned. So we are talking low. I think where we really have to be very cautious is when we are talking about 8 millimeter or lower than that. As well as the sinus of Valsalva mean diameter, which will not allow the native leaflet when it's being crushed by the new valve, it'll go and occlude the left main. In this situation, I think we will go over next what we are the precautions that we will be taking. That once we have done the BAV, have a guide with the wire in the LAD and probably keep a stent already in the LAD. If anything happens, a occlusion of the left main, that you just pull your stent back and deploy it in the ostium of the left main.
And we have done about 10 cases. One of them required the stenting of the left main because of decreased flow, both angiographically, actually, and also picked up by the echo. So decreased flow in the left main, requiring one stent. Others one we were just able to take out. As Dr. Keeney mentioned, that few cases, just the wire. Yeah. And about a handful,
like
six
this
or seven. Had
this
a
kind of case where it is a left main of 10, we have done at least three of them. All of them, we just left the guide and the wire without a stent in place. But the other cases, all where we think we need a stent, that's about 8 millimeter height. That's the time we would definitely place a stent. Yeah.
Okay, next.
And also another criterion might be when we do the evaluation of whether the stent is needed or not needed, to see also the overall structure in the area. So in case you make a judgment of not putting it, is it easy to recross in some ways, or how is that possibility? Because the worst thing that can happen is during the procedure we decide not to place it because it's borderline, and then you may think otherwise, but the access is so difficult that precludes you. So that also is a part of the assessment here. So it's pretty tricky.
Okay, next. Let's keep moving on. That's the next. So this is now.
Yeah, so here you can see our summary size for the valve sizing. We get about 4.4. This is clearly in the 26 millimeter range, 26 S3 range. Next slide. Here the various sizes of the valves.
Next slide. Conclusion, yeah. So this is our plan today, that we are going to use a 26 millimeter Sapien 3 valve with a percutaneous femoral approach under conscious sedation with the TE guidance, thanks to our echo and anesthesia colleagues here, and the pre-empt left main protection due to low left main height. Now, as I said, if you have both combination, is definitely is a deadly combination with a standard if your valve salva is less than 30 millimeter, but it's a 30 plus. But you can see clearly that it's a low left main, and of course, bigger the size of the valve you go, and there's no disease, actually, truly, and so. So, all right. So, right now, we are ready with the valvoplasty. You want to do the
valvoplasty? The hemodynamics, yeah. We cross. We have a 40 millimeter mean gradient. We are ready to do the valvoplasty. So, that's the key.
Needless
we
to
do
say
the valvoplasty, and after that, we will get the guide into the left main, wire the left main to LAD, and leave a 4 millimeter stent, and then get the valve.
And this is actually, it's important to say that if you want to do this technique, the only valve you can use is a Sapien valve, because it allows you to deploy the valve and to have the guide in the left main. And perhaps you noted when Jason was showing us the pictures of the valve types, that the Sapien 3, unlike previous generations of the Sapien valve, had a much bigger size stent cell at the most distal part, so therefore there is not much metal in front of the left main or near the coronary ostia, I should say. And this has been a purposeful design change from Sapien ST or Sapien XT or previous types of Sapien, exactly to address the fact that we don't want to jail with too much metal near the areas of possible coronary ostia circulation.
No, that is actually the very good point. That has been a talk about that some cases you may need a Sapien XT because the overall height of the valve is much smaller, but apparently they will stop producing it. So we have to just settle with
you. If you can go back to the slides, and you know, while they're trying to wire, you can show us the previous slides with the with the different sizes of the Sapien in the PIP, please.
Yeah,
great. So you can see in this slide how the Sapien XT, for example, is a little shorter, but at the same time the cell is thicker. So yes, you gain something about the height, but you lose a little bit in that the top stent is a little bit more involving than the top stent of the Sapien 3 that you see is wider, and the covered part of the stents are pretty similar. So I think you have to pay attention to these top two slides, the Sapien 3 and the Sapien XT, in order to understand the subtle differences between the two generations of the valve. Again, Sapien 3 a little bit taller in total, but with the same height or tallness of the covered part,
DR, I guess,
and the top cells much wider. We can go back to the case, and while we're trying to wire the LV to start with performing the valvuloplasty, you can see the pacemaker in position. This is a great view because you can see the distal edge of the sheath as well, so you don't have to be moving the camera down toward the legs anymore. You can just observe from the thoracic aorta and up and see everything, because as soon as any catheter is out of the sheath, it's already in your view point. I think in the speed to cover everything, Dr. Sharma did not explain well that this patient is under moderate sedation and with TE, which is a good advancement of the anesthesia and echocardiography collaboration in our center that enables pretty routine use of this technique. In other centers, when you want to use TE, in the vast majority of patients, you have to select general anesthesia. But with careful selection of the cases, for the most part, when we use a sedation, we also able to do a transesophageal echocardiography as well, which is a great help in the details of the procedure, this procedure.
We mentioned that that was the first point we discussed this morning.
I know we mentioned, but we didn't explain it, and people may have been distracted.
No, but that is an important point. Yeah. Very important point. That the concept of the sedation. I mean, that's usually they don't go hand in hand together.
Yeah, when something is too groundbreaking, we have to send it a few times to register.
That's it.
Repetition is the mother of knowledge.
Yeah.
Or practice makes perfect, the same thing.
And the other question is that truly, the most of the cases, you don't need the TE. I mean, the transthoracic is good enough. But then there are a lot of issues with the transthoracic that you have to have special gloves. Otherwise, the echocardiographer will come back with six fingers in a few months.
Three, not six. Soft. Maybe they'll lose it.
Soft. Yes.
So basically, I don't know, six, maybe four.
Four or three, yeah.
Then we'll have two thumbs.
Yeah.
Okay.
This is the AL needed actually to cross. Usually we go with the AR2, but now I think this is okay.
No. Let's have the pigtail.
So we had to get in a little bit of a crooked position. Just reflects to the fact that how small and hypertrophy the heart is. But over time, you can see that every beat the wire may end up being in a good position, and the pigtail sometimes helps to reposition this.
Yeah, majority of them we cross by AR2, but we had little trouble to advancing the AR2, and so they use the AL. So once you go with the AL, I see majority of the time you have to reposition your wire, because AL, once you go into the ventricle, particularly small cavity with the normal size and good ejection fraction, it just keeps creating a lot of PVCs, and you just cannot manipulate. It's too big for the cavity.
That's a good point. The AR2 tends to buckle a little bit towards the apex.
Yeah. You need a pigtail to do that.
Yeah, and that's why you need a pigtail. Good. Yeah. Right?
Now we are okay.
Okay.
Now we are in the cavity. Now we go with the
our
we have the balloon
extra
ready.
Support. Yeah. So now this patient has a moderate AI. So otherwise we would have gone with a 22 ZMAD, but we are going with the 20. But our clearly that your valve should be ready at that time, which it is. Prepared, ready, because in case becomes too much AI, so the step by step also keep seeing that when you want to do the left main in time wise.
Give me a 7 gloves, you give me 7.5. Look at that.
So, and at this point, it's customary that the echocardiographer is confirming that the wire is not entangled in the mitral apparatus and that everything is okay to proceed.
Yeah, okay, Partho, you didn't say that our wire is good?
No, carefully observing as you were positioning the wire.
Okay.
Currently, the wire is in the apex. It is a difficult, small, hypertrophied ventricle, so I'm going to be very cautiously observing as you position it.
The wire is fine.
Okay, start pacing at 150.
You can see what balloon you're using, ZMED 20?
Yeah, ZMED 20.
ZMED 20, which is 4.5 cm long. You can see that it goes up in the middle of the valve very nicely and stays there with a fast pace.
Stop.
We pace at 150 these days for the BAV for the most part.
And actually now they have the perfusion valvuloplasty balloon, true flow. So in a patient with a bad ejection fraction, you can use the true balloon, which has the pores proximal and distal, so that really does not shut off the flow.
Yeah, but I always wonder about that because the patient has such a low flow. How much blood can they really push through this little tube? That's exactly. Another story. But at least makes us feel a little better.
Better. I can tell you one. I used one case, but I was not able to open the valve that much so that our experience is n equal to one.
N equal to one, you had to do a second inflation. So I don't know how that worked out. Good.
Okay, now let's talk about the speed. Now we're going to do. We are going to engage now. We have the VL catheter.
So now that's a point that we go back to again to a point that Dr. Sharma mentioned real quick, and maybe people did not register. He said that because there's some AI, he did not want to use a 22 balloon. And the answer is because if you have torrential AI, you really need some time in this case. You're not ready to go in with the valve right away because you have to do this exact procedure he's doing now to engage the guy to the left, put the wire and the stent and all that, and you need a little extra time to do that, so you don't want to risk having torrential AI in this particular case.
And more importantly, it's not a very calcific valve. I mean, except that the nodule which you pointed out on the non-coronary side, cusp, it's really not that much in terms of calcium. Good.
Great.
So now we are in the left vein. We'll just go with your workhorse wire. Whatever your workhorse wire is, we have a run through here. So we'll wire into from the left vein to LAD, and we will have a 4-0, 12 millimeter Zion stent ready.
Well, that's great, and routine anticoagulation here with heparin, ACT around 300, so we're okay for all these procedures without too much thought.
380 ACT.
Now, George, while we are talking about anticoagulation, knowing that you mastered the Bravo trial and showing bivalirudin and heparin, there was not much difference, you think we are going to do any further trial on that?
Someday.
Or we are done with that factor?
Well, we're done with the factor. Bivalirudin is non-inferior, actually had numerically lower side effects of any kind, but the cost makes it not so appealing. Yeah. However, in cases where we saw some cases of patients with HIT and patients with allergy to pork products, as you recall, we had one case at Mount Sinai, the few cases around the world that it's good to have an alternative anticoagulant with good results available.
Okay.
But cost-wise, nothing can beat very little cost of
heparin. You need the blue towel.
And clearly, what we saw in Bravo, the savings in bleeding were not very significant, but clearly can be used with the same dose as a coronary case, as a bolus plus infusion, with interrupting the infusion at the time of the deployment of the valve right after successful deployment with initiation of the bolus right after the big sheath goes in.
Yes.
So it's a very simple thing.
We have some clean.
Yep. All right, so that now wire has gone in, and we are going to put this deflated 4012, park this stent in the LAD.
So it's better to explain all those things, they mean as we see them.
Yep.
Okay.
So the wire has gone.
The wire is in the LAD, and then we have the stent going in. Leave it in the proximal LAD.
And that's what the parking means. The stent is non-deployed and is advanced quite a bit, but not too far.
Yep.
And now the guide will come out.
Yep.
Okay, not yet. So then what you do is you can connect it if you want.
Yeah.
You want it connected?
Yep.
But more important also, this is a minor point, but a very important point, that the guide, your wire, and the balloon, all the Y connector, everything is hidden here. So, away from you. So, you're just now focusing just on the valve. Everything is covered, so you're not touching. The guide will come out.
Okay.
Yeah, guide has
and
to
we're not
be
going to use
our
pigtail. Yeah, we're going to
engage. So, we can use the guide as also for our aortic injections now.
Yes.
So this will be used for aortic injection. And also important, decrease your pressure.
So that's another now. Not only do we have to worry about the wire and about the sheath, now we have to worry also about the stent and the wire in the coronary. So you don't want to inadvertently push or pull them too much while you're deploying the valve. So it's very important to inspect, to have a perfect implantation view that shows everything. The tip of the sheath, the arch and the wire in the LV, as well as the guide and the coronary stent system.
Yep.
So again, checking the orientation of the valve is good. You can see here, skirt facing down, going up.
Great.
Small bites.
Okay, we wait here for the valve to arrive. And the valve already arrived.
Pick out the introducer. Oh, okay. Come out. Yeah.
Very well.
Want to keep that?
Now keep saying what you are planning to do.
Okay. Just we are going to bring this balloon, keep coming
so
down.
So we're loading the valve now. This procedure has to always be done in the descending aorta, so it's rather straight. You can see Dr. Kinney pulls back the balloon into where the stent valve is.
Balloon is
very carefully.
Right here, you want to go a little cranial. I think we are good now, and right?
We want to just center those markers at the stent valve very
and then
clearly
you keep
as
advancing.
She has done it.
Lock and lock.
And now you can see with one hand there is a flex of the catheter while
little flex.
While
now flex. You start when you're in the arch. Little bit flex.
Over as here. Always have to be
going.
A little
advance,
careful with
advance.
The guiding position so we don't dislodge it, which it didn't
This is a very important time that at this time, you know, your guide could either be pushed down or pulled up and the stent could move back or forward. So you just have to be careful, keep advancing.
Yep. And I see that the way it moved, the Sapien 3, and I would say that we'll talk about the neurologic sentinel trial. That's the point which we'll talk on the didactic. Is about the Sapien, that it just goes through the arch with a no-touch technique. So it, because of this, the flex system, it just doesn't touch there. And this is where I would say probably one of the lowest CVA reported of less than 1% at 30 days with the Sapien 3 in the Sapien intermediate registry. And so maybe in the low risk even will be lower.
Okay, we'll bring the
hypertube
backwards.
Good, as far as the valve. Go in a little bit.
Okay,
yeah.
1 second.
You want to go a little more?
Nothing. We'll come back. Expose, bring it up to the middle marker.
So this step is now to expose all these markers in order to not interfere
Partho,
with
can you
the
pull
sheath
your tee up a little bit? 1 second.
During the valve deployment.
Okay, now you see. Show me.
Yes,
now I'm. Your guide is out. That's good enough for us. Also very important point at this time, with all this movement that has happened, make sure your LED wire has not advanced forward or backward.
Everything
looks good.
Everything has worked perfectly in this case.
Yeah. But the valve may be too far in.
Yeah, valve is deep, so it's easy. Let's just manipulate, bring it back.
Pull the entire
fine adjustment, I brought it back.
Yeah.
Looking good. Okay, start pacing at 180, okay? Hold the guide. I'm holding the guide. Inject.
Perfect.
Good. Okay.
You stop injection.
Stop injection.
Anu, have you completely uncovered those markers? I think it moved back in again a little bit.
Yeah, looks that way. I'm going to do that.
Yeah.
You need to. That's an important point. Otherwise, your balloon inflation may be hindered.
Okay. So now you saw that there are various ways to deploy the valve. Some people will start all right with the speed, you know, pacemaker of 180, and then adjust. Too much mistakes, too many activities. So basically what you do, you see that this is the right position, go to your 180 pacemaker and inject. If you are happy, then your second one should be your deployment, the technique, not the first one. First one you just try to see, and rather than moving it back and forth, particularly when you are inflating, is always a trouble. So now confirm.
I want to confirm once more.
By
we
echo?
Increase the time.
No, but let's say first.
Let's confirm by echo. That would be a good idea.
Yeah. Echo T. Partho?
Yes.
Partho, let's show
so
the echo now.
I pushed the T probe down, and you can see that.
Oh, looks good.
Yeah. It's
our goal is what? 60-40? Or what are we
looking? I think it's looking like about 60 in the LV and about 40. 40. Yeah.
Like good. So that's
very good.
Yeah.
Very good. Now you can pull it back up.
Not it. Not it.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
No, he can
one
pull
more
it
injection.
Back.
Okay,
let's
ready.
Do one more verification.
180.
At 180. Very well.
Inject.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's gone
stop.
Down
right
a little.
Down.
Yeah.
Okay.
Pull back a
off
little bit more.
Yeah.
Off. Okay, now I think we are good. Some dye?
Agreed.
Yep. Good, no?
Yeah, yep. Definitely good. Fine here.
Optimal
if anything, don't that's allow good. To
that's
come
good.
Up anymore.
I said that's good.
Okay.
Okay, we're going up now.
Okay.
Start pacing 180. Keep holding SS.
Uh-huh.
Going up.
All right. Off pace.
Okay, like off pacer. Left main looks good.
No, we don't know yet.
No.
There's no EKG
definitely
changes.
Yeah, it has definitely occluded. The valve has come up to the left
yeah,
main.
Sure has, yeah.
Yeah. Look that way.
We all definitely right. have the yeah, big open cell across the ostia there, but yeah. that's
okay.
not covered.
Ready?
So let's see where
so the left main is flowing.
Flowing, I told
yeah.
you that.
I can see the color flow in the left main, so.
Okay.
You engaged? Or?
Okay, off the valve, you yep. take your probe up.
Yep.
You're engaged?
Yeah, yeah, I have
let
it.
Me just reach you.
Inject.
Good.
Yeah, see how close it is.
Looking good. I think you should leave this
let's
alone.
Show us again this
came
picture, great.
Yeah. It definitely has covered it.
Yeah, sure.
The valve came back up. But valve looks okay in the position by echo.
Yeah, I checked the left main.
No
and now
yeah.
the let me just give you
see the left
information
on
about
the on the left side, the valve came
moving.
Up a little bit more than we would like, but still
the
looks
stent
very
is
good.
Bare stent.
Yeah.
Commonly covers.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Good. Okay. If everything is good.
Very, the valve position is good. There is, looks like a little bit of paravalvular at, let me give you some details about that. At 12 o'clock position, but it's mild.
I think it's really trivial.
Yes, yes, I agree. So in lieu of the high placement and mild paravalvular regurgitation, I will consider this is a good placement. The coronaries are flowing. I don't think echocardiographically this is acceptable result and nothing much would be required to be done, but then the team will make a decision on
I think this looks great.
Yeah.
Yeah. Looking good. Okay.
Go show me the.
By T looks great. So let's go back, study the angiogram to see if what we decide about the left main. I think it's fine. It's jailed, but it's jailed by the open cell.
Yep.
Yeah. I think we should leave it alone. See here.
Yeah.
One, the flow is very good. Mm-hmm. Second, you see the leaflet, but you don't see it totally.
Yeah, we
don't. The
there's
main.
Nothing protruding
yeah.
there.
So
I must say,
yeah.
the other area, the other case where, remember, we decided to cover, there was just such a lot of grunge
and
in this sinus that currently
view?
You see very clear.
We'll
so
take a cranial view.
In this case, not bad, but we can see in cranial view, and then Dr. Kinnick very carefully will remove it, but I would like to see this live and with some instruction how to safely remove
yes.
these things.
Yep. Go to one more magnified.
Ready?
Now please,
yeah?
center
yeah.
at the ostium, please.
Inject.
Yeah.
I think it looks good.
Yep.
This would have shown us otherwise. Right, JK?
Agreed. Gonna leave it alone.
No, we can. More
let's
importantly, we don't
yeah.
see any grunge in the in the.
Okay,
we are
taking
coming
sinus. Out with
the
valve.
This one out first.
Let's go live, please.
Yeah.
We can see. We have to see this
yeah,
live
yeah.
To
okay,
to get an instruction on how to
yeah.
remove it very safely
yeah.
without
we
grasping it at the valve.
Okay.
Take the stent out into the guide. Good.
Okay. Very.
And the wire.
Excellent.
Take this out. Leave this one
okay.
in case for the last
let's
picture.
Do a pigtail aortogram if you don't mind. We get a good quality okay, aortogram for the live case.
All right.
Can I change that to
okay, but let's take the other one out first.
Do you want
to oh, yeah, you can you can do it by the other pigtail. You can put the pigtail in the LV and then pull it out and do it from that from the from the other pigtail.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
We will.
Good.
Okay.
So excellent. So the next step will be to show the advance the pigtail in the LV, and then we're going to show you the hemodynamic strip with the LVAO pressures, particularly focusing on the diastolic pressures of both catheters.
AO there, LV now
channels.
Going in.
I mean, echocardiographically, I think it's a good placement, mild paravalvular and very good movement of the leaflets. Hemodynamically, this is very optimal.
This one?
No.
Great.
If you have to do angiogram.
Yeah. Catheter is in the LV.
Yep.
And we're going to connect and
here, flush.
Flush properly first in order to do the. Can you show us the hemodynamic strips now, please? Hemodynamic monitor on the picture in picture. Very well.
We need a flush.
Let's flush
zero.
Both very nicely.
Do you flush?
Zero. Zero is good.
3-0.
Yeah. Open the blue channel to zero, please. Yeah,
oh,
or
it's high.
Shut the
that's a problem.
Yeah, get rid of the blue channel.
Three
there's
zero,
something
zero.
On the blue
no,
channel.
Good.
Let's
go.
Use
okay,
a
nice.
Go to the pressure.
The yellow, which is seems to be very well zeroed, yeah. And the red
nice.
Now.
Nice. Yep. Okay.
And
yep.
You can see that the diastolic pressure is 60 and the LV diastolic is about 20 with a great result.
Okay, good job. Take
let's
out
pull
the
back
parallax.
Now and then we do the and then we go to a let's go to a view that the valve is perpendicular.
Yeah.
Need a wire?
Beautiful. No. Let's pull it all out.
Yeah. Okay, wait. Yeah. It's not coming out easy. Yeah. Leave
put
it.
A wire.
With a wire, yeah.
Come out.
For extra safety.
Okay, now this is what you saw. We tried to get it out with the very little manipulation. If it is the pigtail or any other catheter does not come out that easy, go back with the wire. Go with the wire, straighten the catheter, and then come out.
Great. So now we're.
You can repeat it again, GD. Make another point again.
Yeah, great. So, I mean, Dr. Kinney tried to pull out the pigtail catheter very, in most of the time, just flies right out.
Yeah.
But if there's any resistance, you don't pull out. Maybe it's stuck in something, either calcium or something might interfere with the valve. You don't want to mess it up. You
no,
just put a wire in, take
yeah.
it out. Then you go to a view that shows a valve very nicely perpendicular.
Yeah.
And we're going to do the final aortogram. Can you show us
right?
a little bit more of the aorta?
At the end. Not yet. After this. After this, okay?
Inject. Beautiful.
No AI.
We
beautiful!
See no AI. So as we predicted, trivial AI by the TEs, zero AI by the aortogram. We have a great result with verification of no aortic dissection, very nice flow in both coronaries. We can see it now by this aortogram as well. Had a very successful procedure, and obviously the pacemaker and everything will be removed in sequence.
All right, so we'll go back to our slide presentation. And so issues related to the case, and now, of course, while JK is going to fix the groin. Tell him that
you
next time we'll involve him. Yeah.
Tell him later. No, okay. First we'll
yeah.
see.
Okay. Let's go to the points and basically the Sentinel trial results and the update in the neuroprotection during TAVR. Next. So clearly we know that there are various time phases of the CVA. The most important is the TAVI-related, and that is during the first 24 hours. Well, that is where we have manipulation of our device and so. And of course, the subsequently, the spontaneous risk happens because of the continued disease process. And there, the various devices, which I would say the neuroprotection will work in your first 24 hours, will not give you for subsequently. And those are probably, in my opinion, like dual antiplatelet therapy and antithrombotic therapy and NOACs really will work after 24 hours in reducing the neurologic events after TAVI. Next. So basically, this just basically puts it together that clearly that this will become more important, that cerebral injury, when we talk about the lower STS and younger patients. Because lower surgical risk, younger patients likely have longer life expected over which to benefit from reduced neurological injury. And of course, patients with higher cognitive function at baseline may be more likely to show decline. So clearly that once we are getting to the arena of the low risk tower, the cerebral protection will become more important issue. Next. And what are the predictors? The very simple, that your Euroscore is not a predictor of stroke in TAVI. Predictors of neurologic events in TAVI includes one, whether transapical or transarterial. Clearly, anytime you go to the artery, you will scrape the aorta, you have higher stroke rate. Post dilatation and the valve dislodgement a smaller index valve area and CVA. Patient has a prior history of CVA, will likely to have more event during or after the TAVI. The predictors of new cerebral damage, which is on the diffusion weight MRI, is shown that age, hyperlipidemia, and post-dilatation, and also the severity of atheroma. So clearly in the arch and so, and particularly you're going transfemoral, and of course the long procedure really creates a problem. And then the peak transaortic gradient, you left a higher gradient, pre or post, actually both of them have been associated with higher CVA rate. Next. So basically we know that all the valve types overall is about 3% stroke rate at 30 days. Next. And it occurs in all the valve types, although newer generation valve which are on the right side, which are being used for the intermediate group, like next, like Sapien 3, as I mentioned, is 1 to 1.5% CVA rate, which is really, really remarkable. Some good data on the short, small number of the evolute are also having a significantly low CVA rate. Next. So basically, now very important issue. While the tau, it has been shown the volume outcome relationship, whether vascular complication or death after the TAVR, clearly for the CVA, it has not been shown. The latest data from Dr. Holmes presented in ACC last year, that overall remains the same, about 2.5-2.6%. This is self-reported. Actually, maybe a little higher. But more important is, there is not a volume issue. It is an issue of the device and the patient. Next. And we know that those who develop CVA, which have four times higher 30-day mortality compared to who do not. Next. So therefore, and then a lot of data actually have accrued now, that if you do a diffusion weight MRI in these patients, 80 to 90% will have some kind of a minor cerebral lesions during our TAVR procedure. Next. Now, and this is about overall, so, you know, studies have shown. Next. Now, also, the important is, that what has been shown, that particularly you see the lesion volume and whether you have self-expanding versus the balloon expandable, and it's a little different in some of the trials, but overall I would say with the newer generation, the number is, the field is being equal. Next. Now also people say, well, what about if you have very small lesion? Well, small lesions have shown that are associated with higher stroke as well as death rate. Even a small lesion of less than 3 millimeter. And particularly in young person, they also are correlated with dementia. So it's not only the initial event, it's also follow-up event in these patients. Next. Therefore, put it together, it's like the tip of the iceberg. What we see clinically, disabling stroke and TIA is just a very small part. What happens to these patients with a subtle, undetected neurological decline, with a silent cerebral infarct, so which are unrecognized, so we really have to pay attention to imaging as well as the neurocognitive test, and more importantly, the protecting devices. Next. So it seems to be there are three devices are available, are undergoing trials. Next. The first one of its kind with the Claret Medical Sentinel Cerebral Protection System. Now actually they're changing the word also. They're calling a transcatheter embolic protection TEP, T-E-P, TEP. So these are the protection system. We have largest data with the Claret. Next. And initial data showed that there is a significant reduction by 54% reduction in the new lesion volume using in the clean TAVI using the Claret device. So clearly the stage was set. Next. For the randomized trial of the Sentinel, which was presented by Kodaly in TCT and was accepted the manuscript and the Kapadia is the lead author in the JACC of last month. Next. So basically this was very interesting. One was the safety, where they did a 123 patient TAVR with the Sentinel, and other was the real our test arm, where we control versus TAVR. The pit 121 with the TAVR with Sentinel and 119 had a TAVR only without the Sentinel device. And there are multiple MRIs were done day 2 to 7, day 30, and of course all neurological assessment as well as the neurocognitive examination. Next. And basically, by using the device, one thing that there took more procedure time, but overall there was not much issues in terms of the rest of the technique. But clearly when you're trying to do the device, it takes a little extra few minutes. Next. These are the various the balloons, the tower valves which were used. Predominantly 70% were the Sapien group and 30% were the self-expanding. And this will be important when I'll come back to a little further. Next. So basically what we say, primary efficacy point of view, that there was a 42% reduction in the new lesion volume on the diffusion weight MRI from 178 to 102, which is all the 42% reduction, but did not make a p-value significance. And I would say largely because the numbers were 90 and 98. When they did a calculation, it was supposed to be 122. If you put the number 122 in both arms, this becomes p-value significant. Next. And then second was the safety. The 30-day Mackie was 9.9 in the control group, 7.3 in the device group, 2.6% reduction, but within the margin of non-inferiority. So again, no difference. Next. And these are the individual endpoint of the Mackie: the death, stroke, AKI, TIE, and major vascular complication. As you can see here, that the stroke rate was 9.1 in the control group and 5.6 in our device group. Next. And now also the embolic material, which was captured. In 99% of cases, some debris was captured. You say, well, what was the debris? It was thrombus, acute or organizing, wall tissue, arterial wall, calcification, foreign material, and myocardium. It's amazing that there was a myocardium into many of these cases. So probably we caused a lot of damage to the muscle also, which called embolizers. Next. Now, these are the individual endpoints. Again, the based on the next. The overall the stroke rate, 5.6 to 9.1, disabling stroke was equal, so also the TIA, and of course, central exercise complication was not different. Next. So they also showed that clearly once you develop a high, the patients who develop the CVA, the no protection versus protection, that overall, the new lesion volume, the CVA clearly has decreased compared to in the protection group versus non-protection. Next. Now, this is a very important slide. This is actually really, I would say, the crux of the trial. Why? Because do you see that really the Sapien 3 was the largest number of the cases which were used in the trial, and there is no difference. Why? Because the event rate and, of course, the new lesion rate was much lower. Really, the difference was in Sapien XT and, of course, the Evolute R. So you say, if you use a device where there is a very low CVA rate, so clearly that maybe the claret devices may not be required. But yes, other high-risk patients and maybe some cases, you will require this particularly to make the difference. Next. Now, this actually puts them together that you see Sapien, it was 2.7% lowest of the overall CVA rate in the trial compared to other valve type which were used, as well as the incidence of the stroke. Next. So therefore, next. Basically, what we learned is that clearly, while there was some benefit of the Sentinel of the claret device, but one of the issue remained is that it was not significant. So the overall, you can say the trial was negative, but at least it was a trial of the safety. Safety is yes. Efficacy at least had just paved the path for the future trials, because there was some non-statistical or numerically lower event rate, particularly stroke and, of course, lower lesions. So clearly, it makes sense that in the future, we'll have the device use for reduction of the embolic events. Next. So this actually is coming out in the JACC, last week. I think it just came out already. Next. This actually also very interesting that we just came out in the JACC in terms of overall the tower pathway. So to put things together, that of course heart team approach has to decide what to do. Severe AS, not, then periodic monitoring. If a patient is not functional, do a palliative care, don't do the tower. And of course, if patient based on the risk, if it's a low risk, goes to surgery. And we know that intermediate to high risk goes for tower. Next. 40. So basically, to sum up, the major and minor strokes still occurs in 3 to 8% of tower procedures. And silent brain lesions are very common. Long-term effect of even silent small brain lesions may have important implication when TAVR is done in younger patients. Next. The Sentinel trial using claret cerebral protection system, now we call them as a transcatheter embolic protection in high-risk TAVR and TAVI procedures, have shown device safety and success, and the numerically lower stroke rates and lower new brain lesions on MRI compared to no device group. Future studies need to focus the TAP device use in high-risk and self-expanding tower cases. Next. So we'll go through three questions. There may be some more questions added on because this will be a CME event. One is the following are the true statements regarding strokes after TAVR in the Sentinel trial, except stroke occurred in 5 to 9% of cases. Stroke was numerically similar in the control and the device group. TIA incidence was similar in the device group versus control group. A disabling stroke was similar between the device versus control group. Next. The following are the true statements regarding the silent brain infarct. Post-TAVR, it occurs in 50, 50 to 70, 70 to 95, or more than 95. Third. Next. Is that clean TAVI evaluating claret embolic protection system versus control group post-TAVR used following TAVR valve. Core valve, Sapien 3, Sapien X3, and Lotus. Next. So we'll come back to the answer. This clearly was, what was the difference in the Sentinel? Remember, the numerically lower stroke rate, although did not make a statistical significance, 9.5 went down to 6. So therefore, that is now, say, numerically similar? No. So B is the false answer. Next. Next. And clearly, the embolic brain infarct occurs in 70 to 95% of cases. Next. And the last one, in the clean TAVI, which was the basis of the Sentinel, all cases were with the self-expanding core valve. Next. So therefore, so all the assumptions which they made in the Sentinel were wrongly based because the data were from the core valve, not for the balloon expendable. So clearly, that maybe if the trial would have been done more with the balloon expendable, self-expanding, the outcome might have been different. But I think overall, it's going to the panel because the data still looks good. Very likely, the FDA might approve this Claret device. The cost then will be a separate issue, or they may ask them to do some more studies, and so, but maybe with a self-expanding valve, we don't know. But I think overall, our international community is really waiting for the approval of the device. Maybe, George, you want to comment on that, where we are on terms of approval of this Claret, and then we'll ask JK to show his handiwork.
Yeah, no, not much comment. I think there was a great presentation. We wait for the print publication of the Sentinel paper in the later this month. I think it's next week in JACC. That will be accompanied by several other papers, including related meta-analysis, and the FDA panel will be held later on in the spring, and we go from there. JK, you want to show us the closure as we see
pleasure.
The final result in the angiogram once again.
Sure.
Really great result.
So just to step back a little bit, at the beginning of the procedure, we put a small sheath, actually a 7 French sheath, in the right femoral artery so we could go with the guide up the right side. We had the main sheath in the left side, and we'd placed an 018 V18 guide wire from the right groin down the left artery. We were going to put the big sheath and down to the popliteal artery, or the distal superficial femoral, on the left side. So what we've done here is retracted the large sheath, the Sapien sheath, back to about the bifurcation of the internal external iliac, and taking a first DSA shot. You can see there we've got no problems at all at this stage, no dissection, no leak. We've now retracted the Sapien sheath back further to just about the pelvic brim. We've railed a long 6-7 French sheath over the arch of the bifurcation, and we're now down on the left side. You can see again, no dissection, no extravasation. The next shot, we've actually then pulled the sheath out. I've deployed the two per closed sutures. We have an antegrade and a retrograde wire now. We have the retrograde wire is the 035 wire that we had the sheath on. We have an 018 wire, which is going down the leg. So the next step at this point is to actually put a balloon. We took a 7040 balloon right across that lesion on the 018 wire and did a 6 atmosphere inflation. Pulled out the 035 wire before we did that. You can see it's the 035 wire, the retrograde wire is out, 7040 balloon to 6 atmospheres on the 018 wire. Deployed the per-closed sutures, cinched everything down, and you can see the next shot here looking pretty good.
Very good.
Excellent.
So pull the wire out.
A great closure.
018 wire is gone, nothing left. This is the final shot. See, looks pretty good. No extravasation, no dissection, so end of case.
Beautiful. Now, I'll just ask Dr. Keeney also to comment on this whole neurological issue, particularly we get to the low-risk patient, the TAVR point of view, knowing that no matter what you do, even surgery will have some severe rates. So what do you think, on this very hot debatable point, and particularly the devices have not been as superior yet, and we are a little disappointed with the Sentinel data.
I think in the trial, or if they want to or extend it, they should include the neurocognitive assessment.
No, they have
if
it. You they see have it. No, they the have it. Yeah.
Yeah, but I think what we see actually in the patients, especially intermediate at high risk, and what they follow-up question, they definitely there is a decline in overall their memory power and everything of this patient that should be considered, especially if you are doing low risk, where we are talking patients at the age of 60 to 70 who definitely will be going back to work.
Absolutely. All right, GD, doctor.
Great, and again, the new cognitive assessment will be part of the publication or the supplemental appendixes and this and that, but you know, obviously a little bit too complex to present in the context of a live case site presentation that we had today. This was a great case with a great result, very didactic, left main protection, not needed in the end, but very good and secure to have it. We went through all the steps, great results for the valve with no AI, and great closure of the leg as we see. Next appointment, same day
appointment
and time, here on March 14th. I would like to thank the entire cath lab team. This case is going to be at the Structural Heart livecases.org website in a few days with related CME information. Again, thank you all for your attendance from Mount Sinai Cath Lab, this first transmission of the year. So long.